Hello everyone, welcome to my lecture recital for my senior recital. Go ahead and get on your phones, get on the drive. Studio documents, recital documents, handouts, 2024 spring, and then I'm the only one on there. Whenever you're on it, look up so I know. Okay, I got most people. Okay, this is all in program order, starting with Variations on Dowland's Lachrimae, Pavana by Keiko. About the piece, it's based on a Baroque era lute solo by John Dowland. Keiko Abe, I guess, heard this and wanted to put it on marimba and give a little bit of like the Japanese flair that she likes to do. You can definitely hear both influences. At the very beginning, it is squarely in the Baroque. It is very tonal. It is very much an A. And then as it goes on, it gets out of that and gets more into what you'd know as stereotypically Keiko Abe. The challenges of this are bringing out the right things that I want to be brought out, because it can be very busy. And really just getting to learn like a new style of marimba playing, because I'm not used to playing a whole bunch of Japanese marimba stuff. So I'm going to play the first page-ish for you guys. It should be in the document. This piece is a very well-known, very large setup, fairly long, but on the short end for Mortan Feldman's compositions. If you don't know anything about Mortan Feldman, this is the first, this is not the first. This is one of the shorter ends of his length, like I was trying to say, and some of his other compositions go like single movements, last a few hours type of a thing. And this is very interesting because none of these instruments, with the exception of very, very, very few, are told to me what it needs to be. There are some vibraphone things that happen, just like, and this block note that says specifically what it needs to be, but other than that, it says cymbals or skin or gong, and I get to choose. If you look at the music, it's not standard percussion notation. There are three boxes stacked on top of each other. And what it is the top box is a high-pitched sound, the middle box is a middle-pitched sound, and the low is a low-pitched sound. And that's kind of open to interpretation, however I really want to do it. So for example, this is what I use as a medium pitch sound, or a high pitch sound, or a low pitch sound. And within that, there's no like, a middle pitch is from C2 to C3. It's not that specific. So then, looking at that very first box on the page, it has a number 7 in the top box. So that means 7 high-pitched sounds. And even within that one box, there's so many different ways that I can do that with just my setup. It can be something like this, or it could be totally open to whatever I would like to do to get this piece across to my audience. So I'll play the first little beginning of it. Oh, and this whole piece, there's no sticks, no mallets. It's all with my fingers and my hands, with my arms or elbows if I wanted to. Just no sticks, no mallets. And that would be the first line. So it's pretty unique, and that by itself is the reason why I wanted to pick this for my recital, to get you guys' ears accustomed to this and to get my head kind of in the right space of doing some wacky things. So does anyone have any questions about that piece? I know it's kind of not usual. Dawson.
What exactly drew you to this piece in particular? Was it because of the like uniqueness of the nature of the piece, or is there any? Is it freedom of the piece that led you to choose it?
Well, it is definitely freedom, 100%. It's very. I just get to choose my own adventure, basically. No two performances are ever the same. And I heard of this piece from Mesa's library. I was going through like different multi things, and he played this on his senior recital when he was doing his undergrad. So I got introduced to it through him, and I wanted to put my own spin on it. That's how I came to this. Any other questions? Yeah.
How did you decide the instruments?
A lot of time sitting in the toy cabinet, honestly. Getting, like, there are sections that are gong, and there are sections that are skin, so getting like some landmark instruments, like I wanted to use this as my low gong, and then I went from there to get three other sounds that kind of complemented that, and then I went from there in each of the different like instrument clusters.
Yeah.
Is there any like time notation, or is it all free? Like,
there's a loose time notation. There are boxes in a row, but there's no like strict tempo marking. It's anywhere from 60 to 90 BPM. And I get to choose, and it can change within the composition. I've seen people do sections of it way quick, like about 100, and then slow down to 50. I'm not doing anything like that, but it's not strict. Okay, I'll move on to the next thing for time's sake, Dakota. This is Quicksand by Marco Sharipa. It is a Rick and clarinet duet that highlights most of the different sounds that the Rick can have. And duets with wind instruments are always pretty fun. We do a lot of just percussion duets, but it gets it out of that a little bit. The challenge is learning the instrument. It's not something that we typically study. Learning the different sounds that it has and getting them consistent and getting them to come across to the audience was a severe challenge. Switching between instruments, two different ones, in the middle of this process was a little bit of a challenge, but this is a fantastic instrument. I started with Dr. Cantrell's Rick, and now I'm on this one. It's great. And then working with a non-percussionist, just communicating ideas isn't always the easiest thing, but a benefit was it was on his recital. So initially we were on his time instead of mine. So he led most of the stuff up to his recital, and then it was just polished work on my end, which was super achievable. Put it again up to A. Sonata number 2, movement 4, Allegro. This one, primarily it was learning the massive amount of notes that I had on the page. If you look at the first 5 lines, it's just straight 16th notes with like a couple quarter notes. Just the mass amount of notes, and it is very, very tonal, is Bach. So it's obvious if I make a note mistake. And then past that, trying to learn some of the characteristics and some of the like tendencies of the violin was pretty challenging. I try to do as much as I can to keep the same characteristic of the piece onto an instrument that is not a string instrument. It was a fun little challenge, but that's really all I have to say about that one. I'll play the first little bit of it. Some slight, like partially, not too much. At the beginning of it, it was, I want to get some contrast. But honestly, a lot of pre-screenings and grad schools want a 2-mallet Bach piece on marimba. And I wanted to find, within the pieces that I could do, what would complement my first marimba piece. And I ended up with this one. Because not all of them fit on 2-mallet. Not all of them are like make sense laying on a keyboard. So just picking out which ones work and then narrowing it down from there is really what I did. So it was more of an afterthought, but it was in the process, in the thought process. Anyone else? this piece is a hidden gem. The full piece is a 5-movement, 21-minute work for timpani, and I'm not playing the full 5 movements, I'm playing movement 3 and movement 2, in that order. Movement 3 is the harder of the two. It's also the much longer of the two. It is what is in the document. It is 4 mallets, and those 4 mallets play 4-note chords on timpani, which is something that is not super easy to hear. Definitely not as easy to hear as like piano or any other standard thing that plays harmonies with itself. But it's been enough of a challenge for me to be able to make sense of it, for me to see it as just a challenge and not impossible, and to be able to find some unique ways to be able to hear the notes all the way that low. I started just playing them on the piano. It was crunchy, but I could kind of hear, oh, this is an augmented sound, this is diminished, and it resolves here. And then that influenced my playing to be able to get those harmonic movements out. I'll play the beginning. Just to give a short expectation. This one, no pitch changes, very fast, very light. Questions?
Are the mutes in the second?
still life. I will not have to make this instrument move in the middle of it. Just for this lecture, I have to. The Apocryphal Still Life by Christopher Dean. This has been possibly the hardest thing that I had to work on for this recital. I knew it would be difficult, but I did not know it would be this difficult. And that is okay. I think I've done a good job preparing it. And I've learned a whole bunch while I was doing it. Do you mind if I grab my music from on the piano? Thank you. So this has some lightly prepared vibraphone in these two bars. They are lifted up, so no matter what the pedaling is, they will always sustain. Thank you. And you'll hear that immediately in second measure of this piece whenever I play it. Also, it has a pedal, as a motor, and I ended up switching to Mace's vibraphone because whenever you turn it off, you can hit the side of it and it opens up the fans, which is not something that the ones in the studio do not do. So if you ever have that issue, possibly use Mace's vibraphone. Learning the compositional techniques that were used was honestly more important than learning the notes on the page. If you look at the music, that very first humongous notey run, that is dissected and used in many different ways throughout the entire composition, such as the second line, fourth or fifth measure. It has just a couple, 16th notes. That is every other note of the very first run. And then later on, the third line, it is every other note. And then it has some one-handed harmonics. That's been fun to get to learn how to do correctly. It has some cluster chords that sound like they'd be random, but they're not, and they're always the exact same. They're always those. Any cluster you hear in the entire piece is one of those five. Any crazy run you hear is part of the initial run. And every single note on the vibraphone has a specific purpose. These E's and D's are always used like that. And these two notes obviously always sustain. There are some glisses. Those notes are only used specifically for those glisses. Everything has a very specific purpose. And it's been interesting getting to learn that because it's been able to let me get out what I feel the composer wanted to get out. So I'll play the first two lines or so.
Thank you.
segment of the piece that you demonstrated. Is there a reason you opted for the switching of the mallet on the left hand as opposed to like a four mallet setup that included that soccer mallet?
Yeah, primarily. I need to have, there's an F roll, so it's three lines of music. The very bottom one is used for a lot of the piece as just an F roll throughout the whole thing, and it's this. It needs to be soft. I can't use the same mallets I use for one-handed harmonics, because those have to be very hard. So because I have to have these two anyway, I figured if they're going to be on this stand, might as well pick one up and get a more resonant, more like full fundamental sound and a slightly lower dynamic out of this mallet. Because that versus...
Just for those first few measures, you chose to use the four harder mallets and then switch to the one. Here, what I'm asking is there a reason you did that instead of using three mallets and also the softer one, using the three mallets for the runs and then having the softer one to minimize the switching up until that point where you use the two softer?
Primarily just to make it easier in my playing.
Mm-hmm.
It's just harder only using three. Moving on, I think to the saxophone quartet. If you guys want to go ahead and get up. We'll just play a very short excerpt. Strange Humors by John Madden. This has been performed a couple times, so if you've heard it, you know what this is about. Is djembe and saxophone quartet is how I'm playing it. It was originally composed for string quartet and has been reorchestrated or rearranged for very many different ensembles. It has been string quartet, the original. It has been clarinet quartet, which you have possibly heard. Saxophone quartet, which we've done for the Navy band saxophone symposium, which is super cool. It's also a wind band piece with a highlighted djembe part. Super, super cool. He has taken this piece and used it for a lot of different things, making money for sure. So primary challenges is, one, working with a chamber group that happens to not be percussionists. I got lucky because it was used for something for them before it was used for me. But something super important in the learning process is they got direct feedback from their professor, from their instrumental professor, and that was fantastic for the learning of it. I think if it was by ourselves, we could have definitely done it, but for me, having it on my recital, it has made me a lot less stressed, and it's just been like, they got it, no worries. I don't have to stress about this thing. It's just one less thing for me to worry about, really. Helped a whole bunch. If you're doing any chamber group and they aren't doing it on their own, try and get like the instrumental professor involved for a couple rehearsals. I think it'd be beneficial for the piece as a whole.
Let's do just like, can we start at 18? Can we start at this group of people, they know what they're doing, and it's kind of like a hooray at the very end after six pieces of fairly hard repertoire. Thank you guys for being here for this. I'll see you soon. I think, first, does anyone have any questions? Dawson.
You said you would also perform this with a clarinet quartet. I did see that version. Is there a reason you chose to perform it on your recital with the saxophone quartet as opposed to the clarinet?
Yeah, saxophones sound better. He's a clarinet and he agrees.
Yeah.
truly, it just gives me more dynamic range to be able to act a little bit more like a soloist. With the clarinets, I did it with them, and I was supporting. And I really couldn't like let loose at all. And being able to have the extra dynamic range allows me to make it seem like it's my show a little bit more, rather than I'm supporting them. Yeah, being able to just show off a little bit. And also, I just like saxophones and how they sound. Any other questions? I think as a whole, people who are at my junior recital, this one has went significantly smoother. The repertoire is significantly harder, and I feel significantly more prepared to have this recital. If you're a performance major and you're doing a sophomore or a junior recital, because you have to do a junior one, you'll learn a lot in that first one. And if you're not a performance major, if you're just an education major or a BA, and you want to do a junior recital, it'll just make your senior recital better. It'll just give you more playing opportunities. It'll just give you more opportunity to play with the people that you're studying with, different instruments, different cultures, possibly. We're in Moorhead. But really, I think it's a good idea. And I feel a lot more secure because I've already had one of these. I think you guys should. That's all I have to say. Do you guys have anything? Cool. Well, the recital starts in 23 minutes.
Yeah.
Thank you guys. Can you hit stop?
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
after every single piece, having the applause from everyone makes me feel like, you know, it's worth it or something. I have a million thanks to give, probably to every single person in this room, but I'm going to try and minimize that as much as possible. Thank you to the Percussion Studio for being a part of the journey. There's a whole bunch of freshmen, and I hope that you guys keep it going. It's a very special thing, having the recital and having all the studio members supporting you. So thank you guys for being here, and thank you guys for helping me be who I am. Thank you to Dr. Cantrell in the sound booth, and Dr. Mason, wherever he is. Thank you very much for being the greatest percussion professors at Morehead State University, bar none. It's been a very big journey coming into my freshman year. I thought I was like everything, and then I realized I was nothing, and now I'm a little bit better than I was, for helping me make connections into future grad school opportunities that I'm auditioning for in like a week, and then in 3 weeks for the other one. Thank you guys very much for everything you've done this whole 4 years. Thank you to my very extended family that is here. There's quite a few. Primarily my dad, Tanya, my mom, BJ, wherever he is, and my grandparents, my great-grandparents have made it here. Thank you very much for making it. It made it even better, thank you. Thank you to my girlfriend, Julie, for helping me get everything organized, for getting that music on the board for me, for bringing me things this morning that I forgot, for everything that you've done in my journey since we've met. I really appreciate everything you've done, musically and as a person. Even like, I think this outfit you picked out from the clearance section at Men's Warehouse. I'm probably missing a million, and I'm sorry if I did, but thank you everyone for being here. Thanks so much. I guess whoever wants to get a picture here, and then there is food and other things in the composer's room. Please stick around for a little bit. Picture time.
Thanks for coming to MSU Live. It's a great Sunday, and I hope you enjoyed it.